In this video, we'll study about the coverings of the brain. So the reason state, the brain is soft, grayish and gelatinous organ. Both the brain and the spinal cord are covered by three meninges or the membrane, which are named from outside inwards. You have, this is the dura mater and the pink one is the arachnoid mater and the green one is the pia mater. So from outside inwards you have dura mater, arachnoid mater and pia mater. The dura mater consists of two layers. You have an outer endosteal layer which covers the inner surface of the cranial bones, forms the inner periosteum, and you have the inner meningeal layer. So this meningeal layer is closely adherent to the endosteal layer. In certain sites, the meningeal layer forms folds and it gets separated from the endosteal layer. So this is the endosteal layer and this is the meningeal layer which forms the folds. The folds formed by the meningeal layer are fox cerebri, fox cerebelli, tentorium cerebelli and diaphragma cella. So wherever the endosteal layer and the meningeal layer get separated, it is filled with venous blood that forms the venous sinuses. So this venous sinuses receive the venous blood from the brain, cranial bones, and it communicate with the extracranial veins through the emissary veins. So next we'll see the arachnoid matter. So this is the arachnoid matter. So this arachnoid matter is closely adherent to the inner aspect of the dura mater and it's separated by a potential subdural space. So this is the subdural space between the inner meningeal layer of the dura mater and the arachnoid matter. You have a potential layer space, that is the subdural space, which is filled with a capillary layer of tissue fluid. The villi of the cranial arachnoid matter aggregate to form arachnoid granulations. So these are arachnoid granulations which project into the dural venous sinuses, mainly the superior sagittal sinus and the transverse sinuses. The granulation tissues are the site where the most of the absorption of the CSF takes place into the venous system. The arachnoid granulation are more prominent in advanced ages. These arachnoid granulation, they leave markings on the inner surface of the cranial bone, that is the granular foveola or the granular pits along on the either side of the superior sagittal sulcus. Next we'll see about the pia mater. The pia mater is highly vascular and intimately covers the outer surface of the brain and the spinal cord. The cranial pia lines the fissure and the sulci of the brain. So it lines the gyri and the sulci of the brain and consists of epipia and pia glia, the pia intima. The epipia lines the arachnoid mater and the pia glia covers the surface of the brain and both are connected by strands of pial cells. The space between the arachnoid matter and the pia mater is known as subarachnoid space. So this space is filled with CSF and it is traversed by the blood vessels of the brain. At the base of the brain, the arachnoid space becomes a roomy and forms most important intercommunicating subarachnoid cisternae. So this is the sagittal section. So here you can see these are the spaces, the subarachnoid space filled with the CSF, and near the base of the skull, the subarachnoid space are enlarged to form the cisterns. Next we'll see about the cisterna magna. So this is the cisterna magna or cisterna cerebellomedullaris. So this is the space which intervenes between the caudal surface of the cerebellum and the dorsal surface of the medulla oblongata. And this receives the CSF from the fourth ventricle by passing through the median foramen, or it is known as the foramen of Magenti. Next we'll see about the cisterna pontis. This intervenes between the ventral surface of the pons and the base of the skull, and it receives the CSF from the fourth ventricle through the lateral foramen, or it is known as the foramen of Lushka. And this cistern consists of basilar artery and its branches. Next, we'll see about the interpeduncular cistern. So, this is the interpeduncular cistern or a cisterna basalis. It overlies the interpeduncular fossa and contains the arterial circle of Willis. The next space we'll see is the cisterna ambiens or quadrigeminal cistern. So, this is a space which intervenes between the splenium of the corpus callosum and the tectum of the midbrain. This space consists of great cerebral vein of Galen. The last cistern we'll see is the cisterna of the lateral sulcus. So, this contains the middle cerebral artery and the superficial and the deep middle cerebral veins. The blood vessels on entering into the brain substance, they receive a tubular prolongation that is known as the perivascular sheath. The perivascular sheath extends up to the precapillary level. The perivascular sheath is filled with CSF, and this probably damps down the pulsation of the arteries. The capillaries of the brain are separated from the nerve cells by the semipermeable membrane that is known as the blood-brain barrier. Next, we'll see about the blood-brain barrier. The blood-brain barrier consists of following from the blood of the capillary to the neurons. You have a continuous endothelium with a tight junction. And next is the basement membrane upon which the endothelium rests upon. Next, you have the perivascular feet of the astrocytes, that is the neuroglia cells, around the basement membrane, and they are separated one another by gap junctions. And finally, you have the neuron around the astrocytes with numerous intercellular spaces. All the neurons and the neuroglia are separated from the blood capillary by the distance not exceeding 50 micrometers. The barrier permits the diffusion of the gases and simple solutes of the blood plasma for the nutrition of the neurons. Macromolecules of the protein and antibodies of the circulating blood are mostly held back by the non-fenestrated endothelium of the capillaries. The principal function of the barrier is to provide an optimal chemical microenvironment for the neurons. The transport across the capillaries takes place by diffusion, pinocytosis, or by other active methods. Selective permeability of certain drugs across the barrier is an important prerequisite in the treatment of diseases affecting the central nervous system. In the newborn, the blood-brain barrier is poorly developed. Hence, in neonatal jaundice, the bile pigments pass through the barrier and damage the basal ganglia, producing kernicterus. The blood-brain barrier is absent in pineal organ, the posterior lobe of the pituitary gland, the area postrema, and the supraoptic crest. The cranial pia presents two important features. One is the telechoroidea, the other one is the choroid plexus. The telechoroidea is a bilaminar pial fold which lies outside the ependymal roofs of the third and the fourth ventricle. The choroid plexus consists of tuft of choroidal capillaries which is lined by a layer of pia mater and ependymal cells. The plexus projects into the lateral ventricle, that is the central part of the lateral ventricle, and also the inferior horn of the lateral ventricle, and it also projects into the third ventricle and the fourth ventricle. The choroid plexus is the principal site of the formation of the CSF. Next, we'll see about the blood CSF barrier. The blood CSF barrier consists of tissue which intervenes between the blood in the choroidal capillaries and the CSF in the ventricle. So this consists of fenestrated endothelium. So these are the endothelium with the gaps, which is known as fenestration. So this is a fenestrated endothelium. Next, you have a potential connective tissue space lined by flattened pyoarachnoid cells joined together by gap junction. Then you have a continuous cuboidal epithelium, that is the ependymal cells of the ventricle, which are connected to one another by tight junction provided with microvilli on the free surface, and this rests upon the basement membrane. This is a general introduction to the coverings of the brain, the spaces of the brain, the subarachnoid space, the cistern, the blood-brain barrier, the blood CSF barrier, the telechoroidea and the choroid plexus. In short, we'll see in detail in later videos.
Thanks for watching that video.